بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله على آله وصحبه ومن والاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد firstly I apologize for lateness I'm just came from speaker's corner الله ما هذه ذات الحمد لله زي الشيء بالشيء يذكر Speaker's Corner is a place when there is khair in it, no doubt. But sometimes you do get caught up in debates, useless. But there is khair. So, that's the evidence at our table. Sometimes you miss up people who are mad. You know, doesn't mean you should stop giving da'wah. There is khair, alhamdulillah, in that place. You know, but to go every week, I don't know about that. You lose your mind. But, Alhamdulillah, I mean, there's brothers there from there, two brothers. I'm not sure if they came today, but they came last time. Both of them were Shia, and we gave them da'wah. Alhamdulillah, they became Sunni in the park. There's many brothers that we met from there and brought them here. Alhamdulillah, like last week, alhamdulillah, two people become Muslims. Alhamdulillah. And that place is open for da'wah, and people come from different parts of the world. So people don't like the Salafis to be there, it's the Hizbis, they don't like it. The Hizbis don't want us to be there. Because why? We clarify the Aqid of Salafiyya. We warn against Khawarij, Hizbiyin, Ikhwan, Tablighiyin, and so on. Likewise, we give a da'wah to non-Muslims. So there is khair in it, alhamdulillah. But what I've noticed, I've experienced, subhanAllah, evening, late evening, normal people leave and Majnun come. So sometimes you're speaking to someone, if you're sincere, then you end up speaking to Majnun. But that should not stop us. I mean, stop people to give da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what Sheikh Salim bin Mahrez, when they told him, and when he came to my house and I told him, I don't do it anymore. He said, no, you go, carry on. Go give da'wah. So alhamdulillah, there is khair. But today, my brothers and sisters, what I want to speak about, something I've been thinking about. Because a lot of you, mashallah, mentioned before many times, shabab, young. But I've experienced, there were many brothers that started with us at a young age, 15, 17, then they stopped practicing. So what is the sabab? You see the mashallah, if you do that maw'idah, I'm talking about the brothers that were practicing at the age 17, 15, giving maw'idah, they start crying, you know. So, wallahu ta'ala, a'azu a'alam, can I say like, this is from the experience. Some people worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thinking he's going to die tomorrow. So he's going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our ibadah is based upon three pillars. The ibadah, the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is based upon three pillars. What are they? What are the three pillars? I believe all of you know it, but I'm just speaking, maybe it's tricky.
Sincerity,
Allah. No, that's not one of them. They're talking the pillars. Hope, fear, no,
love.
Yeah. So as you know, the when you worship Allah, based upon love, we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based upon fear, we fear His punishment, and we hope in His forgiveness and to enter us Jannah. So we are servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded His prophets to be upon istiqama. نعم فاستقم كما أمرت. Be upon uprightness. كما أمرت. The way you've been commanded, not the way you feel like. Huh? So you worship Allah the way Allah commands us to worship Him. So this happened to brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. They used to come masjid, niqab, jilbab. Next minute, everything's been taken off, stop practicing. Because he's thinking, oh, I've been practicing for 5 years, I haven't died yet. So I have time to do something that make a tawbah. I have time to do haram. But we don't worship Allah just like that. We worship Allah because Allah deserves to be worshipped. In Jannah, there's no death, but we'll be worshipping Allah, glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah. So, tasbih, tahmeed. The Malaika, they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah, when you understand that, that we worship Allah because He deserves to be worshipped. Because the question you ask yourself, okay, imagine someone tell you you're gonna leave, or the angel tell you Jibril comes. Okay, you're gonna die after 200 years. So why you're not gonna worship Allah? So I have a time to haram. Subhanallah. Ibrahim alayhi salatu salam, or Nuh alayhi salatu salam, another 50 years. And he worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we understand this concept that we are a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibadur Rahman. So you don't start thinking, I've been worshipping Allah for 2 years, practicing 4 years, and now I'm 25, I still have a time, I haven't died yet. So, subhanAllah, no. You worship Allah because Allah deserves it. He's our Lord, He's our Creator. Na'am. We worship Him by following His commandments, and we worship Him by staying away from His prohibitions. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am, all of us, we make mistakes, we fall into sins, your iman gets weak and so on. But you have to understand that always you have to strive, you know, struggle to jihad against nafs, you know, against our souls. You know, the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Qasas al-Anbiya, the story of the prophets in the Quran, for us to take benefit from it. Take a benefit from it. So for example, people say, for nearly 200 years now, or 100 years, Muslims still weak. You know, when Allah is going to give us the quwwah, or khalas is over. No, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, 950 years. 950 years. They say, khalas, 950 years, I still have time. Or his followers. No, they were worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you wear jilbab, my sister, you are wearing it, you think tomorrow is going to die, you're scared, that's it. Because you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you follow Allah, you are servant of Allah. You know? So this is one of the things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. The amad, the life become longer for them. So their hearts become what? Hardened. Subhanallah, wa'iyadu billah. Ibn Qayyim mentioned one of the worst punishment that Allah can give to the servants, what is it? Ghildat al-ham, ghildat al-qalb. The hardness of, when your heart become hard, harder than the rocks. Nothing affecting it. Wa'iyadu billah. Listen to Quran as if you don't listen to nothing. Maw'idha as if you don't listen to nothing. Nothing can, that if you reach that situation, if we do reach the master, we're not safe. Now, reach that situation, know that you have to be on point, begging Allah to remove that. Allah said, "Ran ala qulubihim ma kanu yaksibun." Ran, ran means their heart become covered because of the sins. La yunkiru munkara. Does it not recognize evil or recognize good? Wal-iyadu billah. So we don't want to be like those. And Ibn Mas'ud mentioned about this verse, was revealed not way longer after Prophet ﷺ became Messenger of Allah. You know, subhanAllah, Allah reminded him with the verse. And us, subhanAllah, may Allah protect us. We turn away from the Wallahi, there's nothing sweeter and beautiful and better than being to be upon istiqama. Like I said before, people who are doing haram, they make dua to be upon istiqama. But those who are upon istiqama, they make dua to not Allah send them away from istiqama. Subhanallah. So, you know, sometimes I reflect. I should listen and follow the advice of Sheikh. Sometimes certain thoughts comes to your mind, cannot come again. Sheikh Salah Sheikh mentioned, he said, you should write it down straight away, there and then. That's why Fa'ida, Imam al-Bukhari, they said he used to wake up every night more than 10 times or something. Why? Every time he remembers something, he wakes up and he remembers, okay, there's a Fa'ida moment. He goes, write it down. Then he goes back to sleep. Imagine that. That's why those, they're on a different level. I mean, even the ulama of our time, Sheikh Fawzan, there are different levels, subhanAllah, may Allah preserve them. So they shared, barakallahu ikum, because I'm thinking, look, mashallah, a lot of young shabab come to the masjid. I've been around, may Allah give us sincerity and keep us firm. I've been around for a long time, you know, but I see people coming and leaving, practicing. I see some brothers, mashallah, practicing, mashallah, you see him with the imama, with the shimar, you know, qamis, kitab, you know, mashallah. Next minute goes off completely. Subhanallah, why? What is the sabab? You know, some sisters with niqab or jilbab coming to the classes, goes off. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ May Allah save us and may Allah guide us and guide them. So I say, why? Because one of the things, you always say, imagine I die tomorrow, so I have to worship Allah. Yeah, but even if you're going to die maybe after 6 years, you're not going to worship Allah. Think like that. Malaika, did they say, we're going to live until Yawm al-Qiyamah, we're going to worship Allah? No, Allah. The reason we worship Allah, because Allah deserves it. When you understand that, He's our Lord Jalla wa Ala, He's our Rabb, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, Al-Malik al-Quddus, Al-Mu'min al-Muhaymin al-Aziz al-Jabbar, Al-Mutakabbir al-Salam al-Mu'min, Al-Wahid al-Qahhar, Jalla wa Ala, you understand that you are nothing in this king, in the kingdom of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. When you understand that, then if you have to be servant of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I fall into sins, let me go back and repent to Allah Jalla wa Ala and do righteous, increase righteous actions. You know the hadith of the malaika, that there is malaika who, since they've been created, they've been bowing down to Allah or making a sujood to Allah, prostration to Allah. And when yawm al-qiyama, indama taqum al-qiyama, when the day of judgment will be established, they will say, our Lord, we have not worshipped you the way you should be worshipped. Akhwa, can you come forward, please? Come, akhwa, there is space here. Come. Come forward, barakallahu fiqh. They will say, our Lord, we have not worshipped you the way you should be worshipped. Imagine their life, or their lives, since Allah created them, either they are in a state of a ruku'a or a state of a sujood. Subhanallah. And they say, oh, our Lord, we have not worshipped you the way you should be worshipped. So, us, like one of the Salaf said, if you calculate your life, most of your life you'll be sleeping. That's our life. Most of our lives you are sleeping. How long have you been worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Even that worship, was that worship sincerely? Is it accepted? You know? So we should, all of us, including myself, me giving this reminder doesn't mean I'm perfect or I'm the Abidul Zayd. No. All of us reflect, like I mentioned this many times, this qawl of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, I love it. Every one of us, every one of each of us, we should have a time to reflect. Aikum salat wa barakatuh. To reflect, my brothers and sisters. As I say, Al-Hal Yurtalah, the time we're living in is very sad. So the sister contacted me, said, you know, there's some people that do this, do that. I said, you know, sometimes forget about people, focus on ourselves. Yes, you can look at the people to take lessons from them. If you see someone smoking drugs and you see how we tend, then you take a lesson. I should not be smoking drugs. Look, subhanAllah, this verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu alaykum anfusakum la yadurrukum man dhalla idha ihtadaytum. Oh, you who believe, take care of yourselves. You shall not be harmed by those who are misguided if you have followed the guidance. So, reflect upon ourselves, but that doesn't mean we should not enjoy good from the evil. Because many people misunderstand the verse. However, we focus and try to rectify our ourselves and look at what caused people to deviate from the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Sometimes al-ghurur. Al-ghurur, what they call it, deception. The person become deceived with himself. He become arrogant, as if he's doing favor to Allah Jalla wa Ala. You know, when you start doing that, then know that you are going to deep hole, wal-iyadu billah. So, you know, all of us, we should reflect upon Allah's creation. You know, subhanAllah, I was listening to one of the mashayikh said, how many people say I made dua, but my dua was accepted? For how long you left your house and you came back healthy? And you made dua over the dead, leaving the house. So Allah accepted your dua. Huh? How many times you enter market and you said dua and nothing happened to you? How many times you went to sleep and you made dua and Allah gave you life again? How many times you tried to do something and you made dua and Allah made it far away from you? All this dua you forgot, Allah accepted it? But what is it? What shaitan does to Bani Adam, that when you start going through hardship, you start panicking. So what the shaitan does makes you forget about the rest of Allah's blessings. Makes you forget that you're healthy. Alhamdulillah, you have a family. Alhamdulillah, you're able to go to the bathroom by yourself. Alhamdulillah, you're able to wake up by yourself. You don't need someone to wake you up or maybe take you to the bathroom and so on. So you forget all these blessings and you remember just the hardship. So that, subhanAllah, shaitan, what it does, it makes you forget ni'am Allah Jalla wa Ala. So what we do, we should reflect. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ وَالْلَّيْلِ إِذَا يَسْرِ هَلْ فِي ذَلِكَ قَسَمٌ لِذِي حِجْرٍ أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِعَادٍ إرم ذات العماد التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد وثمود الذين جابوا الصخر بالواد وفرعون ذي الأوتاد الذين طغوا في البلاد فأكثروا فيها الفساد فصب عليهم ربك سوط عذاب إن ربك لبالمرصاد فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه ربه فأكرمه ونعمه فيقول ربي أكرمن وأما إذا ما ابتلاه فقدر عليه رزقه فيقول ربي أهانن. That's a shahid. That when an insan, Allah put him through hardship, he said, my Lord, have abandoned me. SubhanAllah, he forgets all Allah's blessings. We forget all Allah's blessings. And we say, Allah, our Lord abandon us. SubhanAllah. And remember, we will talk about this general advice, my brothers and sisters. May Allah bless you. May Allah bless you all. That when you're making dua, you're not giving a commandment to Allah. You are begging your Lord, your Master, your Creator. You're not commanding Allah to do it. This is begging. You know? So when the Sheikh mentioned that, how many dua that you made in different situations and the dua been accepted? Look, subhanAllah. You still surviving. Alhamdulillah, you haven't died. You know, still healthy. So shaitan, if you go through hardship, don't forget the blessings of Allah upon you. Reflect upon that. That's why the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam looked at al-Mustafa alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, when it comes to dunya, look to those who are below you. Why? Why he said that? Why Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that? Because it's in hadith. To not belittle Allah's blessings on you. So when you go to visit al-Marda in the hospital and you see people be laying down on the bed for I don't know how many years, and you see people and you leave the hospital, you're ashamed of yourself in front of Allah. You know, subhanAllah, people cannot eat. So, I mean, they have to, like I said, they have to use, they get someone to help them to use the bathrooms and so on. But you, healthy and everything, then you forget. So all of these blessings, you know, we get the oxygen in, out, while we're speaking, the air in, out. But you say, no, I still have a long time to worship Allah after. So why not worship Allah for the energy that is given, I mean, the oxygen that is given you for free, everything. That's why if we try to count Allah's blessings, we'll never be able to do so. So when we start trying to raise ourselves upon this way, will humble us. You know, humble us. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam How many years was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I remember I mentioned it before. The verse was revealed that Allah has forgiven you all your shortcomings. Yet, standing. Qiyamul layl. Standing at night. You know, us, we don't even know if we're going to Jannah or not. We ask Allah to enter Jannah without any reckoning, without any punishment, likewise for our families and the loved ones. But Al-Mustafa alayhi salatu salam, standing, praying to Allah, even Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha. She said, oh Messenger of Allah, you doing this even though Allah has forgiven all your shortcomings? He said, ya Aisha, ala akunu abdan shakura. Should I not be grateful to my Lord? Should I not be a grateful servant to my Lord? Imagine that. That's why Sheikh Sa'ad Sheikh mentioned that in Aqidah al-Wasit Tahawiyya, that all the prophets and messengers have shortcomings. Why? Because regardless how much we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyone, you will never repay back Allah for his blessings. Just the blink of the eye from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So regardless, that's why the prophets and messengers, they do istighfar, not because they're sinners, wal-iyadu billah. No, because they know that's how you make up the shortcomings or try to rectify those shortcomings. All the prophets, even Jesus, Prophet said, if the hadith in Ibn Hibban, Ibn Albani made a sahih, Nabi said, if Allah held us accountable for our shortcomings, he will punish us without doing injustice to us. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. The hadith is صحيح بن حبان. So what does that mean? That regardless how much you worship Allah, you're not doing favor to Allah. Oh Allah, I've been worshipping you for a long time. Why I'm going through hardship? Why so-and-so is not doing, nothing's happening to him? Why it is me? Subhanallah, na'udhu billah min dhalik. That's why we don't ask for fear, for trials and tribulations. But we ask Allah if we go through hardship to aid us, to keep us firm, to aid us and to keep us firm, my brothers and sisters. Wallahi, the biggest calamity to die upon ma'siyah, and the worst than that, to die upon shirk and kufr, iyyadu billah. You know, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam used to say, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Oh, the change of the heart, keep my heart firm upon your deen. So read, my brothers and sisters, my brothers and all. Read Qasas al-Anbiya, the story of the prophets and the messengers. You know, read Surah Yusuf, Surah Ibrahim, Surah Al-Nahl, read all the Surah Qaf. Read the Quran, read the story of the prophets. Make sure you have a time to read the Quran. Make sure you have a time to read the story of the prophets and messengers. Those stories, Allah don't mention them for the sake of mentioning them. No, to take lessons from them. You know, to take fawa'id from them. Subhanallah, look, Ibn Uthaymeen said, look to Allah's hikmah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim, his father is kafir. Nuh, his son is kafir. Lut, his wife is kafir. Asya, her husband is kafir. Subhanallah. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, his uncle kafir. Look, Allah tries people. Subhanallah. Your father, you're a messenger of Allah, but your father is kafir. Your messenger of Allah, but your son, he's the wife. Subhanallah, to show you. So where is it here that if you have a problem with your children or with your wife or with your husband, then you take a lesson. For the sisters, take the lesson. Ummu Salama. Who is she? Ummu Salama. The wife who? Before she was married to Abu Salama, yeah, it's a Sahabi. You know, but you know her story? This her story show you the thabat upon Iman. Woman, by text, you take a lesson from her. Ummu Salama, when her husband, they were about to migrate to Mecca, the family came and said, okay, we cannot stop you, but there's no way you're taking our daughter with you. So they prevent him from taking the wife and the son. So she said she used to go out every day just crying because she wants to leave. You know, she wants to go. She was patient. She didn't take off her hijab she's changed her religion. Even though she was in Mecca, that time Mecca was Darul Kufr, the land of Kufr. Her family putting pressure on her. She said, us now, our sisters, may Allah guide us and guide them. No pressure on them. Easy to take off the jilbab and hijab and everything. Umm Salama, she take it off. Or she didn't change her deen. She was patient. Then, is it one of the tribes from her family said to the parents, it's too much, let her go. She's going for hardship, let her go see her husband. Her husband is in where? Medina. She was traveling. On the way she met one of the Sahaba. He said, where are you going, ya Amat Allah? He said, I want to go to my husband. He said, I will take you. And he took her. She was traveling by herself from Medina, from Mecca to Medina in hot weather. For the sake of who? For the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Because she wants to go to see her husband and practice the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umm Salama, one of the great Sahabiyat. That's a role model that our sister should be following. Not these singers. But the Shahid, she didn't say, oh, you know, khalas, Allah gave me excuse. I can't, let me stop practicing the deen of Allah. Let me worship Allah. No. You know, reflect my Allah, ikhwa, make sure you have a time. It's my advice to you. And that's one of the things after Allah's tawfiq, keep me going. When I look at the asbab, the reasons that people deviated, and look at the story of the prophets and messengers, the story of the Sahaba, listening to the biographies of the ulama, that will help you. And likewise, before that, reflecting. Who you? Me and you, no one, nothing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know? We should be, rather, we should do everything to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because that's our honor. You don't want to be honored? All of us, you want to be honored, right? You want to have izzah. The izzah is not by following the adab of Islam. The izzah is by following Anbiya al-Rahman. Wa sayyiduhum al-Mustafa alayhi salatu wa salam. So for the prophets and the messengers and the leader of them, al-Mustafa alayhi salatu wa salam, and his companions. That is the izzah. Barakallahu feekum. So this is my advice to you, may Allah bless you all, about trying our best to be upon istiqamah. And also, as we have mentioned many times, doing istighfar, you know, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. You know, all of us, sometimes there's ghafla, heedlessness, no doubt, but we have to remember and do istighfar, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and reflecting upon Allah's creation and reflecting upon ourselves. And we should not let the shaitan tell us away from the sirat al-mustaqim. والله تعالى أعز وأعلم وصلى الله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وسلم سليما كثيرا بارك الله فيكم. If you have any correction or something, you're more than welcome, inshallah. And there is a books inside the office. أخي مادي, please, can you ask Ammar? There's a books. The books, the brother brought them. I'm gonna give as a gift if you answer a question. Is he bringing the machine? Yeah. Oh, barakallah. Yeah, I apologize again. We've been waiting for long, and I bless you. Inshallah, it will not happen, inshallah. I'm going to try to come in time. Okay, there's kutub here, and these books, mashallah, I read this book. Called Discipline of the Soul by Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala. It's a very nice book. Alhamdulillah, he doesn't speak about the soul, what is soul in details, you know, but speaks about how, for example, this praise of al-hawa, desires, you know, refusing to take position of authority in this world. You know, ulama, they used to run away from positions. Sheikh bin Baz, when they put him a judge in one of the areas in or cities in Saudi, he said to people, Wallahi, I don't want it. I don't like it. However, look to the Salafi bin Baz, Abdul Aziz bin Baz, rahimahullah. So, however, because the leader told me, so I have to obey him. Averting spitefulness, yeah. Averting arrogance. Averting is good for the people who swear. Averting excessive thinking. You know, my brothers and sisters, everything should have a manhaj. Even the way you think. You know, sometimes your mind can be disaster for you. You know, you can be a victim of your own mind. Because that's why you need the shara to control your mind. Because what Allah created, the aql that Allah created is so powerful. But if it doesn't have, if you don't control it with the shara of Allah Jalla wa Ala, it will become a disaster upon you. It's a test for you Allah giving you. But Allah give you shara to tell you the way to use it. Self-discipline. Discipline the children. Anyway, let me give you the question, inshallah, and you can. There's mashallah, how many? Inshallah. All right. Okay. How many Sahaba were with the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam in the battle of Badr? It was quick.
307.
315. They said 315, 307, Mushkila. Yes, 315. The one for 15, I think he has to take it. It's 300 more. You said just 300, brother. There have to be more. You know? Okay, the. Give him the book then. In what year Al-Isra wal Mi'raj occurred? Someone like this, someone, I don't know which one is written that. Who was written that before you, Ahmad?
Was it the second year after the
Hijrah? No. So the 8 years of the da'wah started. Someone said what? No, not second year. It was not 8 years. It was 10 years. Who said it? 10. After prophethood. Yeah, so he was 50 years old when Isra wal Mi'raj occurred. Yes, 3 years before Hijrah. Yeah. So it was the 10th, because that's how they calculate it. After prophethood, years after prophethood, or years after Hijrah. So they say the second year after prophethood, the third year after prophethood, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The other question. I want to ask questions about the Prophet's biography. What year Sulh al-Hudaybiyah occurred? The Treaty of Hudaybiyah. Treaty of Hudaybiyah occurred. Ikhwah, try to move away from the curtain. Barakallahu fikum. What year? have you guys a good sister this question? Because I forgot about sisters. The sisters, you can answer by writing down the answer. Barakallahu feekum. Alhamdulillah, this is a masjid should be. Should be given books, not shoes. The masjid is not Selfridges or House of Fraser. You know, you give books people to learn. Now you're giving people Gucci and Farsashi and, you know, learn, bring them learn. You know? So for the sisters, the question, yeah? What year Salah Hudaybiyah occurred? What year Mecca, afwan. Hajj was Hajj soon, yeah? What year Hajj was what? I was gonna say, what year Hajj was Hajj? What year Hajj was legislated?
90.
Huh? 90. 90, yeah, mashallah. Okay, another question. History, tarikh. Huh? You have to learn about personal biography, huh? النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام which غزوة he participated, is it مؤتة or تبوك؟ Oh, here's his hand. Could you search تبوك? Where's his hand? تبوك, that's not the question, there's more coming. Yeah, okay. Because is تبوك correct? In تبوك, who he left behind him to be in charge of Medina. No, it's him. Well, mashallah, two books then, yeah. Mashallah, yeah. Yes. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, when he went for Ghazwat Tabuk. Do you know where Tabuk is?
Sham.
Yeah, Sham, where exactly now?
Syria.
No, not Syria, Jordan. He's in Jordan. Tabuk. He's in Jordan now. Naam, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left who? Ali ibn Abi Talib behind, mean in charge of Al-Madina. Other question. In the Salat, in the prayer, imagine I'm standing, I come back from a ruku'. Instead of saying, Sami'a Allahu liman hamidah, I say, Rabbi ighfir li, then I say, Sami'a Allahu liman hamidah. If you come back from a ruku', I say, Rabbi ighfir li, Sami'a Allahu liman hamidah. What do I have to do? Why do I have to do? I have to. It's a bit tricky, this question. Pay attention to the wording. What do I have to do? Because remember, I add something. I add istighfar in a position, yes? Two rak'at, no, you're wrong. Two rak'at, we're going to make extra?
Yes, you do the salah.
But I think I want to catch something. What do I have? Do I have to do sujood salah? No, here sujood salah is not wajib. Here is mustahab, but I will give you the book. Here. Yeah. You know, because there is some, that you have to learn this masail, there is some positions when you have to come sujood as-sahw, and some is mustahab, is recommended to come with sujood as-sahw. Another question about Salat. If I miss two obligations of the Salat, for example, I miss to say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in the sujood. Then I miss to say Rabbi ighfirli between the sajjatayn. I miss to say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in the sujood. And also I miss to say I did not say Rabbi ighfirli between the two sajda. What is upon me to do?
Repeat the salah.
لا يعني تصافيك كيف كيف ما نسيت بالاستغفار وال نسيت ما قلت بين السجدتين ما قلت ربي اغفر لي وفي السجود ما قلت سبحان ربي الاعلى هذه ايه جعفر لا لا نو ركعه it's obligation for obligation don't make ركعه ها سجود ساهو صحيح how many times Who are you listening, brother? You're following? Who is going to say five times? You're going to say five times? MashaAllah. Mean, sajda, come back,
yeah.
So one sujood sahw.
Yeah.
Or is it two, one? Which one? What means two? So you do sajda,
yeah.
Come back, sajda, come back, sajda, come back?
No, no, no.
So one, yes, that's what I'm saying. Is it one or two? One, okay, yeah. Alhamdulillah, you're right, actually. One. No, you know why? Because some people think, okay, if I miss obligation, what do you have to do? Sujood sahw. So he's thinking, okay, now I miss two obligation. So mantiq, can I say logic where dictates sujood four? No, the ulama mentioned, you do sujood sahw once. That's sufficient. So, you know, if we miss obligation, what you do? Obligation, you do sujood sahw, okay? A pillar, you do repeat the pillar. You know? So example, I miss, I said, Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh, ask prayer. I prayed three. Then I remembered that I only prayed three. So what should I do? No, one, because I want to give the book. You asked already. Good. And then? Sujood sahw means. Yeah. Yeah, what was the answer? What was the answer? What was the kitab? Okay, there's a question to the akhawat now. The question to the sisters. Oh, the children, they haven't answered one, Akhi. They have to answer one. You can see them, you know, this curtain. Maybe they need Google. You don't know this Google or not? Huh? Who's that? No, but this question they're asking. There's no answer, but there's a question I've been asking. Short time? I don't know. But anyway, subhanallah. Now, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, during his lifetime, all his children died except one. You asked Nu'man before. Khalas, Baba. Fatima, na'am. Fadalaki. Amin, amin. Barakallahu fi. Except Fatima. Oh, subhanallah, all of them died before. Oh, the sisters will answer the question. You keep talking about Khawat. Alas, give them the last book anyway, because any of the Khawat is Kitab. Khalas, Khawat, may Allah bless you all.
Bonus question.
Huh?
Bonus question.
Bonus question, what? Give me my book? Alas, next time, I don't know, maybe give you the box. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. You know, it's good, you know, that's how you learn. You know, there's different types of questions, you know? So that's how we revise. You see, when I'm teaching you, when we're studying, I'm revising too. I'm learning too. Certain things I don't know, and I'm learning, you know? So may Allah give us sincerity. May Allah make us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us humble. And may Allah forgive us and our parents and our families and our loved ones. Wallahu ta'ala a'azu a'lam. Sallallahu nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. وسلم سيدي كثيرا بارك الله فيكم